Perfect. So at the outset, let me convey a very good afternoon to everybody. Thank you so much, participants, for joining us all across the country. I can see I have 125, 23, 24 participants now, and we are at just a three, so I'm pretty sure we have more participants joining up. So just to give you a quick intro, I'm Rajesh Kumar Singh. I'm the Director and CEO for International College of Financial Planning. We are a part of the Bajaj Capital Group. Bajaj Capital Group for sure doesn't need an introduction. It has been into the wealth management and financial planning industry for close to 6 decades now. We have been in the business for 58 years. And here at ICFP, the college that I look after, International College of Financial Planning, we spearhead the financial planning education in the country. So I am extremely privileged to even share that the world's top four certification in personal finance and financial planning, CFP, that certification was brought to India by us. So that's the kind of background, the leaders that we carry. And Kanaya, I am getting a message here. Why is not clear? Am I clear?
There is some, little disturbance in your voice, sir.
Okay, so let me try to come up a little closer to the screen. If that helps. Is it better now?
No, sir. It's same.
No. Okay. I am using a Bluetooth device. Let me disconnect the Bluetooth device and use this.
Probably that's the reason.
Is it better now? Can I hear?
Perfect, sir. Perfect.
Okay. So I was saying, so Bajaj Capital doesn't need an introduction. It has been in the wealth management and financial planning space for 58 years. And ICAP, the education arm of Bajaj Capital Group that I take care of, we spearhead the financial planning education in the country. And as a matter of fact, this world's topmost certification in personal finance, CFP, Certified Financial Planner, that was brought to India by us. So that's the kind of lineage that we carry. So guys, you know, many of you have been attending our webinars earlier. You know, it's like a custom at ICAP that we come across. If after every 15, 20 days, we come and meet you people, we share thoughts on the financial planning. And we also keep bringing in industry experts. And you have seen industry experts coming here, talking and sharing their ideas, their notes with you. I am extremely privileged and honored to have Ms. Aparajita Sharma with us today.
Thank you.
So Aparajita has a long, kind of credentials that I have to share. She happens to be a well-known financial journalist. She has been associated with some of the topmost financial journalism names, financial news platforms in the country, like G Business, India Today, Business Standard. So she has been writing, she has been researching on the financial areas for quite long. So we invited, and she happens to be a journalist from IMC. She is an alumni of IMC. So I was very excited, very thrilled that why not bring somebody like Aparajita, who opted a very unconventional career, meaning to say that, look, typically what happens, finance professionals, Ashok, I can see some disturbance if you can mute everybody. So when a finance professional comes to your mind, typically you kind of imagine people working in the BFSI domain, or you imagine people like us working in the financial industry, but you do not normally imagine people working as a journalist. So that's distinction that Aparajita has, and I thought, why not invite Aparajita and let her share her thoughts with all of you. So Aparajita, I'm extremely privileged to have you here, and I am
my pleasure.
I'm also very happy, very honored, and my entire ICFP team, in fact, loves seeing Aparajita back here, because Aparajita has been our alumni as well. She's for the CFP program with us. So that's a kind of very happy moment to us, an alumnus coming back and sharing her thoughts. So I have introduced Aparajita. She has a long thing to share, so I won't take much of time. I would hand it over to Aparajita. Just two ground rules for the entire conversation, entire webinar today, gentlemen. One, we have deliberately kept all of you on mute. The idea is that when ma'am speaks, she is absolutely loud and clear. You can hear her voice. You can hear her ideas properly. But that doesn't restrict you from asking questions. If you want to ask questions, you can write down in the chat. We will take up questions. Or you can raise your hands. My team will allow you to unmute. But my only request is, when my team allows you to unmute, please unmute your video and audio both. We want to see you live and then answer your questions. I would request rather if all of you can put your cameras on, we can see each other, that will be better. The second thing is, the webinar today is in two parts. One is where Aparajita ma'am is going to talk about her ideas on financial planning, kal aaj aur kal, meaning to say the years that she has spent in the financial journalism. So she will try to bring in the capsule form that how has financial planning evolved? What is the future? What has been the journey so far? What is the future? And what is there for professionals, for people like you in the financial planning domain? So that's what she would try to bring across. And then the second part of the event is where I come back and I'll talk about the CFP program, the world's topmost certification in the personal finance space, Certified Financial Planner Program, which Aparajita has also done. So that will be the second part, followed by the first part, which Aparajita ma'am will do. So that's the format. And I think I have made the rules very clear for you today. So with that note, let me go back to Aparajita. Aparajita, once again, a warm welcome to you. And thank you so much.
Yeah, hi everyone. And thank you so much, sir, that you invited me here. And it's always great to go back to a place where you have studied from and then going there as an expert and sharing your views. So it's like a dream comes true, that the place that you belong to, the place that you have studied from, and now you are back there interacting with students. So thank you so much, sir. And I would like to share my screen. I have a PPT, and that's how I'll go about my speech today. Yeah, can you, is my screen visible to all?
Yeah, it is.
Okay. Yeah, so sir has already given my introduction. So
I would request if you can put this in the slideshow mode, it will become bigger and easier for people to view.
Yeah,
perfect.
So I am a certified financial planner and a journalist. And I say that a major part of my career has been in journalism, and CFP I recently did. So in just March 2021, I cleared my CFP examination, and journalism I've been doing for 8 years now. So it's a little bit about myself. And I did my CFP, all preparing for CFP examination, 5 modules I went for and everything. I studied from ICUFP. So Dinesh Gupta sir was the one who taught us largely, mostly all subjects he taught, sir. Then we had Abdesha who taught taxation, and then we have Ruchi ma'am. So a lot of teachers there helped us clear CFP and handheld us throughout. So 2019, I started studying for CFP, and then COVID happened and things got delayed and a lot of things happened. Still, ICUFP handheld us, and consistently I had opted for physical classes, and they turned us so then online classes we went for. So everything quite smooth studying from ICUFP. Now coming to today's topic, which is financial planning, kal aaj aur kal. So I keep it in three parts. So first part, I'll talk about how financial planning has evolved in India. So, and I won't get into all textbook examples and how financial planning happened and things, nothing textbook. This entire talk will be based on my own understanding, my own observations, how I have seen financial industry shaping up in last 2-3 decades. So first of all, I'll talk about that. And then second part, since I'm a journalist, so I'll tell you that even if you are doing masters in finance, or you may have decided to enter into financial industry profession, but I'll tell you what different kind of professions you can seek if you are studying finances. So that will be second part of my talk. And lastly, I'll interact with you, and whatever questions you have for me, I'll address those. Okay, so financial planning, first of all, the past. So if we talk about our parents and our grandparents, so what financial planning meant for them? So if we look at maybe 50s, 60s or 70s, then financial planning had no meaning because per capita income was too low, just about $100. So if you had such low level of per capita income, then day-to-day living takes precedence. You have to live your day properly. You cannot plan your months or years. So financial planning did not have much meaning back then. So whatever people will earn, they'll spend. And of course, one needs to save for rainy days. So people will usually keep their money at their home. And banking as a concept was just evolving. Nationalization also happened during those decades. So banking was evolving, but still people did not have that confidence to put money in banks. So gradually it evolved. And so financial planning, you are earning, you are spending, and whatever little you can save, you will put it either at your home in cash or you will put it in banks. So this is what financial planning was for our grandparents. And if we talk about our parents, so maybe in 80s and in 90s, then banking people had now trust in banks and they will easily put their money in banks and fixed deposit, whatever money they had, if they want to maybe plan for children's education or their marriages or even for their rainy days, something emergency money. So they'll keep that amount in FDs. And if they have to save for their daughter's wedding, son's wedding, then they invest in gold. That gold will help them liquidate their money if they need something, if something happens to the family, then gold will help them. It holds even true. Our parents tell us, please invest in gold, and whenever you are facing some issues, you have your gold and you can sell it and you will have that money. And talking about real estate, so FDs, gold and real estate, largely that is where people will invest. And that too, not linking it to financial planning. Financial planning as a concept did not evolve even then. And I would say that financial planning, even today, people don't understand that well. But initial, of course, financial planning and investment started happening from banking, savings, bank account, then fixed deposit, then gold, then real estate, and then insurance. So LIC came into being in 1956. So after that, insurance as a concept also evolved. But insurance means, insurance is if something happens to you, then the insurance company gives you money to your family to take care of them. So insurance in purest form of insurance did not connect with people. And that is where savings linked insurance policies came into being. That if something happens to you, then of course your family will get money. But if you live through the policy period, then also you will get some amount of money back. So savings-linked insurance policies clicked with people, and insurance agents started selling those policies. And LIC has more than 95% of business through their endowment policies. Endowment meaning savings-linked insurance policies. So such kind of policies also were being sold as an investment option, that and people went for it. So maybe if you have to save for your child's education, then child-linked endowment policies people will sell. And our parents, our grandparents, they will buy such policies in form of financial planning, that they are planning for child's education in that sense. So that is how insurance came into being. And purest form of insurance, which is term insurance, did not click with people back then. It still hasn't, but things are evolving. And if we talk about mutual fund investment, so it was negligible. In 90s, in 2000, people did not invest much in mutual funds. And here I'm talking about middle class families, not a high income generation, high income people. So mutual fund did not, it existed, stock market existed, but people had suspicious about it. They do not want to invest in mutual funds. That is how it used to be. And mutual fund, for right reason that people did not invest in mutual funds or a stock market, because you had double digit of fixed deposit rates back then. So you will get your FD rates at 13%, 14%, and you had public provident fund, that too in double digits. So when you are getting such high returns from government guaranteed products, from banking products such as FDs and such as PPF, then why would you invest in stock market where again you have compound annual growth rate of just about 12 to 15% maybe. So mutual fund and stock market did not make sense for common people back then. So which was fine that mutual fund did not click with people. And so that is how financial planning was back then. You only have to live through your days or months and just little bit amount of money for your child's education, for your child's marriage. That is how people understood financial planning back then. Now, if we look at today, in today's generation, again, talking about middle income families, not talking about a high net worth individual or a high net worth individual. So people like us. So now mutual funds are becoming mainstream. And people have started investing in it. So if we look at the size of mutual fund industry, then it is 37.41 lakh crore. It used to be around 24 lakh crore in 2018 and 2019. So in just about 2 years, it has grown quite a bit. And FD investment, so total FD investment in the system is more than 150 lakh crore. And 20 to 20% of it is mutual fund investment. And this percentage is gradually growing. So people have started investing in mutual funds. Why? Because now FD rates, now PPF rates, EPF rates, all are declining. All are coming to lower single digits. So 7.1% is PPF rate, 4% to 5% FD rate. So people want to invest in instruments where you can get good amount of money, good amount of returns. So that is why stock market and mutual fund investment is growing. And SIP inflows. So latest data if we look at, then SIP inflows in a month, in September, 10,000 crore worth of SIPs have happened in September 2021. So it's a huge amount of money that has happened in just 1 month. So mutual funds is growing and it's a positive trend. It should happen. But one major worry that I see is direct stock investment is also growing. It's good, but it has its pros and cons. So March 2020, market crash happened in just a day, more than 30% fall in Nifty and Sensex benchmark indices. So it happened in March 2022, and gradually market started growing. And then I think more than 100% returns have come back. So the benchmark indices, their levels have doubled in just about one and two years. So direct stock investment is growing. Record amount of DMAT accounts are being opened. So one data point I have mentioned in the slide here, 38 lakh new DMAT accounts were opened in FY20. 38 lakh in entire FY20. And in FY21, 1.22 crore. So huge difference. 38 in FY20 and 1.22 crore new DMAT accounts in FY21. So a lot of people are investing in stock market. And here stock market is not mutual funds. Here direct equities. So people are investing in direct stocks also. How it will play out going forward, well, one doesn't know that. But I would say that it's a risky trend and people should understand that direct equities are risky. And let's see where it goes. But again, financial planning as a concept, what the true meaning of financial planning is, it's still not clear to people. So goal-based financial planning where you compute your goals, that this much amount of money I will need for a specific goal. And if we take into account inflation rate, then how much money we need to start investing in from this day itself. So such kind of financial goal-based financial planning is not happening still. So that is a major worry that we have. And so again, real financial planning, the meaning of real financial planning is still missing. And now I will talk about high income category. So those are the people who are taking their financial planning seriously, and they are approaching financial advisors, they are approaching them and they want their financial plan made and proper systematic financial planning now. They understand why it is needed. And here HNI is okay, all big startup entrepreneurs or big business families, not just them, but even maybe IT boom we have had. So a lot of IT engineers are there and other such people who also have their ESOPs with them. So a lot of people get company shares. If they are working with a company, then they will also get company shares from their own company as part of their salaries. So they have earned a lot. They have good amount of money and they can shell out maybe 1 lakh or 2 lakh in a month as saving, not just as a salary. They can shell out this amount of money as an investment. So talking about those people, they cannot manage huge amount of money by themselves, and now they understand the meaning of financial planning, and they are approaching registered investment advisors, or maybe their banks. If you have good amount of money in your savings bank account, then banks allow you an RM. So relationship managers will approach them, and they will help them out with their investments, or such different kind of, and mutual fund distributors are there, and there are registered investment advisors also. So these people are approaching them for proper financial planning. But talking about retail investors, so people who can only shell out maybe 5,000 or 10,000 rupees per month, so they cannot afford financial planning fee. So the fees that you have to shell out to avail of your financial plan, to avail of advisories, exactly where to invest, how much to invest, such things require money. You have to pay a fee for it. So retail investors cannot pay that fee because they can only shell out 5,000 to 10,000 rupees, and just how much can they spend to afford financial planning. So here now you have all these new age apps. So talking about Paytm Money, ET Money, or Crow, or Zerodha Coin. So you have these new age fintech firms with their fancy apps, and you sign up there and you see all these mutual fund products, and even stocks you can directly buy from there. So all those things are available and people are going for it. And even if I look at my own friends, so they will also sign up on these platforms and they will choose products by themselves. So this DIY approach of investing is emerging, but it has its pros and cons, because you can pay those people. So today market is doing well and they are seeing their investments growing, but suddenly if market falls and their investments are in negative zone, then what happens? Then whom do they approach? Just calling up on customer care won't serve them. They have to have a person who can address their queries. So DIY investment is looking all hunky and dory now. But just how long it will go on, one never knows. So financial planning, again, if I look at today, the things that what I observe, that retail investors are largely going to all these fintech platforms, and rich people who can afford financial advisory, they are going for registered investment advisors. So here to tell you about how industry works, you all are financial services students, so you may also already know it, but still just to brief you. So SEBI has categorically informed, SEBI has categorically said that only registered investment advisors can charge fees for financial planning. And mutual fund distributor, they cannot advise. They can distribute products, they can sell the product, but they cannot charge fee for it. And only registered investment advisors, they can charge the fee, but they cannot sell regular plans. So I'm sure you understand the difference between regular mutual funds, regular plans, and direct plans. So regular plans have distribution commission involved in it, and direct plans are directly from the fund house. There you don't, their distribution commission is not involved, and those are cheaper plans. So registered investment advisors who are charging fee for financial planning, they cannot sell regular plans. And mutual fund distributor, of course, they will sell regular plans because they have to earn commission. If they are selling a plan, they, of course, they also have to make money. So they will only sell regular plans. So industry is divided between two, either mutual fund distribution space or RIA space. Now, all those big investors, all those people with money, they can afford RIA fees, but retail investors cannot afford RIA fee. And retail investors, so that is the challenge today. Today, what I feel is that registered investment advisors are needed, and we only have 1,300 registered investment advisor in our country. Only 1,300. We have in a country like us, where financial planning as a concept is growing and people want to invest in stock market, people want to invest in different kind of financial instruments. So only 1,300 registered investment advisors are there, and mutual fund distributors are there in huge number, but but they have conflict of interest. They would want to sell products that have a high amount of commission. Whether they do or not, it's we cannot, I can't comment on that. But of course, if you are earning your income through commission, then you would want to sell high income, high commission products. So here that conflict of interest exists, and retail investor, this market is huge. We have to address that. So that is one challenge that I see in financial planning in financial services industry. So if I talk about future, that where this industry will grow, then I would say that all HNIs, ultra HNIs, they have started moving to RIAs because they can afford their fee. So they will move towards that. And the rest of other people, mutual fund distributors are the one who will serve them. So of course they cannot charge fees, so they will be selling all regular plans, but that is how it has to be. The only one thing that can happen for retail investor at low cost is robo advisory. So robo advisory meaning that you have all these platforms like Kuvera. So Kuvera is a robo advisor. So they have RIA license, but they work as they have robo advisory with them. So you will sign up and they will ask you different kind of questions, that what is your risk appetite. So entire your information, financial information, they will seek just online. You are giving them those information, and based on that, they will suggest you products that is where you should invest. And that is how it will evolve. So for retail, and now with robo advisory, you can invest in direct plans. So you are getting some amount of, you are getting good advisory here also, and that too at low cost. So that exists there. But the only challenge I see here is that, again, it's all computer based, it's all online. But if we talk about our money, then we have to have some physical connect. We want to speak to someone, and we should have a personal connect with the person that we are seeking advice from. So this is so I wanted to just update you on it. I wanted to make you understand that this is one challenge that I feel we have in industry, that is low cost advisory. For now, robo advisory is serving that purpose, but it is not perfect. But for investors who can afford advisory fee, they are moving towards registered investment advisors, and maybe SEBI going forward can come up with more regulations and may address this challenge of low cost advisory. And going forward, we may have RIAs who can charge low fee. So today RIA fee starts somewhere between maybe 10,000, 20,000, and it goes on and on. So the well-established RIAs will charge fee maybe more than 50,000 also per year. So so we have to look for ways of low cost advisory to address retail investors. But of course, financial planning as a concept is evolving. It has reached to that level. If financial planning as a concept means goal based financial planning. So goal based financial planning has evolved. It has reached to HNIs, ultra HNIs. They are going for it. They are doing it in a systematic manner. Retail investors still not doing it, but they are warming up to this concept and they are moving towards that direction. And if you understand this, if you understand the true meaning of financial planning, then you should make aware your own people. So if I talk about myself, so I started doing my SIPs back in 2014 and 15. So since then, I have been telling all my friends that start investing, that is how you should invest. And all those things I have been telling to my friends. So I will, my advice to you is that you also start doing that, and among your people, your cousins, your friends, you should tell them that start investing, and all those things are needed. So this is to sum up, financial planning in the past was banking, fixed deposit, still those things exist, but people have started warming up to mutual funds, to direct stocks. But goal-based financial planning in systematic manner, the thing that we need desperately. So these things have started happening. So going forward, I see all retail investors moving towards robo-advisory and doing that. And I see scope for mutual fund distributors also, and their path, they have a huge role to play. And then RIA as a concept, people approaching registered investment advisors also, it is happening. So that's the end of it, the first part of it, that financial planning, kal, aaj aur kal. Now, talking about innovative career choices. Yeah, so here, I talk about myself, my own career, how it has evolved. So right after my graduation, during my graduation, I used to take French classes, French language classes, just a hobby. I started taking language classes, and right after my graduation ended, I got a call. I am from Kanpur. So this French classes I used to take at IIT Kanpur. So I was studying there. And right after my graduation, I get a call from DPS Kanpur that if you are interested and as a part-time teacher, you can start teaching French in our school. So I was getting this opportunity as a part-time. So I took it up and I started teaching. But teaching, I was not interested in teaching as a career. So I started doing it, started earning, and it was going well. I was earning good, but that was not my call. So I used to wonder and a lot of confusion that what do I do in my career? And I always loved writing. I had that thing in my mind that I love to write, but never thought about becoming a journalist. Gradually it happened. I gave that examination, IIMC. I appeared for it. I went through it and I started studying journalism. Now, why I share this story is because you have to understand what you like doing. So even though you have a well-established career, even though you have been putting efforts in something for years, but if it's not clicking with you, if you're not liking it, then you should switch ways. So always do what you love doing. Only then you will achieve success in the career. Otherwise, you won't. So which is why I entered financial journalism. Politics did not attract me. So from the very first day, I decided that if I have to do journalism, then I'll stick to financial journalism. I won't get into politics. So you have to understand your preferences, that you as an individual, what you like doing. So that is my just a small story that how my career evolved. So financial journalism, I started doing from 2013 or 14. I started working as a journalist. And now then COVID happened, a lot of things happened, and I saw the organization that I was working with. So suddenly a lot of layoffs started happening. So people with 20, 25 years of experience and being with that company for years, they were being laid off. So at that time, then I decided that why one has to be associated with a company, why cannot have my own thing? Why cannot I work independently? So it was a huge call to make. It was difficult because when you have your monthly salary coming in and you have a secure job, then taking that call that no, I want to work as an independent journalist, it was difficult, it was challenging, but I still went for it. So in April 2021, I decided that no, I don't want to work in corporate setup. I want to start my own. And by May, I resigned from my full-time job. I was working with Business Today magazine and I have worked with different places. So I started my career with Economic Times and I moved to Business Standard, Z Business I worked with, and then Business Today magazine I was working for 2-3 years. For I think more than 3 years I worked with Business Today. So I resigned in May 2021, and then by June my notice period ended, and from July onwards I started working as an independent journalist. And I would say that things are going great. So if you are in journalism profession, then you have a good network, and if you are good at your work, then of course you will get opportunities. And thankfully I have been getting those opportunities, and not just from journalism. So I write for Fortune India, I still write for Business Today, and I write for different media houses now. So I pitch my stories to these places, and if they like my idea, then I write for them. And then I also have corporate freelancing. So mutual fund companies or broking institutions, brokerage firms, they also have requirement for content writers. So if they have some requirement for me, then they suggest me that this is the topic that I want you to write on, then I write for them and I charge for it. So that is another way to look at it. So one form of content writing can happen in journalism. And then you also have these mutual fund houses, these insurance companies, these brokerage houses, where you offer you can write for these institutions. And then very recently, just about a month ago, I also started my YouTube channel, and now I create videos. So, and that would, another interesting story that I would like to share, that during Zomato IPO, I think it came in July it happened. So I recorded a very short video on Zomato IPO, that why you should not invest in Zomato IPO, and I put it up on LinkedIn and other places. And Angel Broking marketing team may have seen that video, and they approached me that, can you create such videos for us? So of course I went for it, I said yes. So that small 2-3 minute video gave me an opportunity from Angel Broking, and I started creating videos for them. And then I decided, if I'm doing for them, why cannot I do it for myself? So I created my own YouTube channel, and for last 1 month, at least 1 or 2 videos per week I have been putting up on my channel. So blogging and vlogging can also be a career option. And lastly, so blogging and financial journalism and content writing, these are my ideas to you, that what I did for myself. But you can innovate your own career the way you want to go about it. You may have your own thoughts. You may know your liking or disliking. And that is how you can have your own career option, that how you want to grow in your career, how you want to evolve, in which direction you want to grow. So that is all. So now I would want to hear your questions, and maybe that is how we can take it forward. Rajesh sir, back to you.
That was lovely presentation, Aparajita, and extremely happy to see all those thoughts very well structured. So participants, you can ask questions. All you have to do is raise hands in the Zoom panel in the button that you have. By the time you raise hands and my team unmutes you, there are a couple of questions in the chat. So let me take that to Aparajita.
Yeah. So do I look into the chat box, or people will ask?
Okay, so Sanjay, I am looking into it.
Sanjay, you can unmute yourself. Question. Sanjay Agarwal ji.
I can see 2 questions.
Yeah, Mr. Sanjay Agarwal, you can unmute yourself if you have a question. Ma'am, Aparajita ma'am, if you have read the question, you can probably answer it by the time.
Yeah, so one person asked that he's already a mutual fund distributor, and what to do more, what else can he do to earn extra income? So my first advice, of course, is that you should go for CFP. You do your CFP course, and when you have that CFP designation with you, then you can offer financial planning, financial plan as a service along with selling products. And when you do that, of course, more people will come to you. That is one option. And another, go online, create videos, and try to get as many customers, maybe reach out to more people, and not just physically, so take online route and go about it.
I can see a question. What do you think about crypto?
Crypto, I have created videos on crypto also. So I will say that crypto, as a first-time investor, so a lot of people who have never invested even in FDs, they are asking about cryptos. So I tell them that as a first-time investor, you should not get into it. I myself don't believe in it. I have not invested a penny in crypto, but if someone has time, if they can invest time understanding this space, so don't listen to others and just invest in cryptos, read about it. And if you read it in detail, because I have people who understand the space quite well, and they are making money, and they are doing even SIPs in cryptos. So hats off to them, and they are doing it for themselves good, but I wouldn't recommend investing in cryptos.
Okay, so I have Sanjay Agrawal, who says that he comes from an engineering background, and how can he start his career in finance? So Sanjay, Sanjay, as Prajita was introducing herself, she shared she had done her master's in political science.
So
generally what we perceive is finance is a little complex and it is meant for people coming from commerce background or science background and this and that. Imagine she coming from hardcore political science background, I mean political science, coming and moving all the way to be one of well-known financial journalists.
I will say that start reading financial newspapers. So I did my master's in political science and I was teaching French and I went for IMC examination and then financial journalism. So I used to write blogs on finance. I had a blogging site and I used to write weekly articles. So I would read newspapers. So Mint, Business Standard, Business Today, all these newspapers I'll read, and I on Monday I'll decide that this is the topic on which I'll write a blog by the end of weekend. So that is how I grew. I used to read a lot, and reading and also writing. So reading, writing, that is how I went about it. So I will suggest that if you want to learn financial journalism or if you want to learn financial investment, just read, read and read.
Perfect. I can see a lot of questions around CFP certification, program fees, etc. So guys, for that, wait for another 10 minutes or so. I'll bring you the entire new framework of CFP program, which is there in India for last 1 year. So I'll explain you the entire framework, the examination, the curriculum, fees and everything. Don't worry. We will come to that. Prajita, another question is, are there any financial planning apps or software?
Financial planning apps and software. So yeah, as I told you that robo-advisory. So all these new fintech apps, they have such services. So you can go and do that, but this is not personalized per se. But if you are getting it done from a person, from a human being, of course, that is a better way to go about it. But certainly there are apps like Grow, there are apps like Kuvera, all these platforms. If you go up there, you will get your financial plan made in minutes. But how well it would be, how great it would be, I cannot comment on that.
Okay. Mr. P.V. Sajan has a question. He says that I see most don't offer direct plans for kids.
Come again? What?
I am also unable to decode it. So, Mr. Sajan, if you can probably write it again with a little more description.
Yeah, if you can unmute yourself and ask a question, that would be better.
Yeah.
A lot of questions are coming in the chat box, so tracking it is really difficult.
Kanaya, I can see two raised hands. If you can unmute them one by one.
Someone has asked John Thomas, what is the name of my YouTube channel? So I will share the link of my YouTube channel.
Yeah, that will be great.
Yeah, RSG, you can go ahead.
Hello.
Yeah.
Oh, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, Prajita, my question is that because my background with the HDFC Security as a financial planning manager. Okay, I work for the HDFC Security as a financial planning manager, and now I'm with the Kotak Life and the health insurance, care health insurance. Okay. And most of my client, actually, they are the senior citizen. My question is to you is that what future you're looking in the FDs, fixed deposits? Because most of the senior citizens, they have got a very, fixed rate of return instrument tool.
They have fixed rate of returns.
And rate is coming down now. So they don't find any other instrument where they have to invest. Because stock market and this kind of things, are volatile. Okay.
So they should go for all these senior citizen savings scheme or post office schemes or debt mutual funds also. So it's sad that interest rates are at lower side. So maybe you're doing their financial planning in the sense that some bit of it is invested in stocks, but of course major part of it has to be in fixed income instruments. So maybe debt mutual funds or senior citizen schemes and MIS such schemes be needed for them.
But what the future, maybe in the I would say maybe in the coming 5 or 10 years, actually what are the rate of interest you are looking for in the FDs?
Rate of interest, I don't see it going at least double digits, impossible.
No, it won't happen.
Maybe for senior citizens, at least it may go 6 to 7%, but not beyond, because historically in interest rates, you know, always are on declining trend.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
5 के अराउंड 4-5% था, उसके बाद 7-8-9% 9 तो नहीं 7-8% तक गया, then again back to 5-4%.
They come down up to 1%, 2% like this, like that.
It happened developed countries में already it has happened. So
वही है ना.
Which is why mutual fund and stock market investment is needed and disciplined way of investing, so that people know that.
So what I suggest to my these senior citizen clients.
So at the moment they will have to stick to all low income instruments. Nothing else may happen. Some bit of it can go in mutual funds, and that is how wealth creation may happen with that amount of money. But it has to happen through debt mutual funds. They have no other option.
And how? Sorry. And you know that some of the cooperative banks, so they are offering the higher rate of returns. And but how the cooperative banks works in India? You know that.
Right.
You know.
Right.
Some of my client actually they have stuck their money into the banks actually. You know. So
cooperative banks, PMC bank example.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. So very tough time for them actually, because government is not doing anything actually for them.
So diversification, some bit of it has to be in equities, and maybe diversifying your FDs. Some bit of it may be in private bank, well-known banks, and some bit in small finance bank, which are giving you 8% returns.
So मतलब थोड़ा कम मिलेगा चलेगा, but don't take the risk into this kind of you know cooperative banks.
वही है, डाइवर्सिफिकेशन आपको लेना पड़ेगा, उसको रिस्क रिवॉर्ड को प्ले करना पड़ेगा. सो नॉट सारा पैसा नहीं डाल देना है कोऑपरेटिव बैंक्स के पास, बट यू कैन डाइवर्सिफाई अगर आप रिस्क रिवॉर्ड को देखते हुए चलो, आप उनकी रेटिंग से कौन बैंक्स की क्या है.
अच्छा, आई गॉट वन मोर क्वेश्चन फॉर मी एक्चुअली. ओके, सो एट दिस मोमेंट एक्चुअली आई एम डूइंग यू नो द ओनली टू प्रोडक्ट्स लाइक लाइफ इंश्योरेंस एंड माय फोकस इज ऑन द हेल्थ इंश्योरेंस एट दिस मोमेंट एक्चुअली 80% ऑफ माय बिजनेस इज कमिंग फ्रॉम दैट. So now this CFP which you're talking about, actually suppose I have to go it all about, so as you given the data actually regarding how the retail investor and HNI, what is the difference between that? So what are the future you're looking into that one actually?
Future of what? As in
CFP in the career.
So if you have CFP with you, if mutual fund distributor or insurance agents, if they have CFP also with them, then they'll understand customers' need better.
Right.
And if they have it, and if they project themselves as a CFP, then the trust factor on the part of customers will also go there. And if you can also take RIA license, then even better. Then this role, as in we need more and more CFPs, we need more and more RIAs in our industry. From money point of view, if you are asking, then CFP, as an individual, your profession, it will enhance your value, your own value. You can sell yourself better if you have this designation, and you can understand your customers' need better. You will have more understanding of how financial planning works. You are
Mr. PV Sajan, you can unmute yourself.
Hello. Rajeshji, I was unmuted right now. Harsh.
Okay, yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi Parichita, I had a couple of questions. One thing, first question is that I am planning to do my CFP and going forward, can you help me to write content like for my company which I formed, like for my practice? Would it be possible to do that? That was one question. Second, that what do you see the outlook of the robo advisory which is like coming in? That is the second question. And the third question is that currently in my research and finding about all the CFPs who are there, now every most of the people I'm finding, they have their websites, plus they have inbuilt certain things, and you know, so going forward, like as once is doing CFP, what preparations also one needs to do, because we are now in the digital golden age where the reach can be like quicker and one can build over it, like 5 months or 6 months or 8 months it might take to complete the CFP program, but to hit the road running to create all these things, to do that, you know, how can one do that and create that marketing system with content and emailing and etc., writing snippets and sending it to our prospective leads, friends, or you know, relatives and all that, you know, do this, do that, and educating them about like financial. So that's what I intend to do. That while doing my CFP, I want to start writing content, like sharing content, create content, and keep sharing so that I can start building my credibility at the same time. Can you help me with the content writing also?
Content writing, we can take that offline. I will my number. This is my YouTube channel link, and when you click on it, this is the Bitcoin video, very short video that is there. And my number, I'll just type it out. My email ID. So this we can take offline. And yes, building your brand. So again, if you will have your own channel, if you have online presence, your LinkedIn profile, your Insta profile, that is how you can reach out to your people, as you talked about. And if you have to start sending out mails and all those, so technological part of it, I'm not a right person to know how to build that system that you can reach out to more and more people. So maybe WhatsApp, you have broadcast that 254 people can be in one broadcast. That is how I do. So if I have to reach out to many more people, that is how I do it. But technological part of it, that is where the role of robo advisory has come. They have figured out the technological aspect of it, and that is how they could build a robo advisory and AI ML based advisory that is there. But in financial planning, I have to say that personal connect is needed, and robo advisory cannot give you that. So it won't grow at fast pace. I don't see that happening. So personal touch is needed. So low cost advisory has to be there. How it will happen, we have to think ourselves that how we can provide low cost advisory to people around us. Robo advisory is not an answer to that. That is my understanding.
The last two quick questions, because we have to quickly move to the second part of the day. We have other events lined up today as well. So, Mr. PV Sajan, you can unmute yourself and go next.
Yeah. Hi, can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yeah.
Lovely. Thanks so much, Prajita, for your presentation. The query again is about direct plan for kids. What I've seen is that none of the online service providers who pride themselves about providing direct plans like Kuvera, Grow, ET Money, and none of them provide any plans, direct plans meant for kids. And I believe they are the right, target segment. And, I was meaning to tell you that they are the right target segment who's going to make sense, the most sense of the direct plan. And ironically, none of them are providing any direct plans through the online platform. Most of them, everyone that I approached, all of them are telling me to go straight, to the mutual fund AMC and then start the direct plan, which doesn't make much sense. Is it that something that I'm missing, or is it as a matter of policy that they're not allowing direct plans for kids on online platforms?
No, so direct plans for kids, as in they are not marketed. So if you want a direct plan, if you want to start investing for your kids and that too through direct plans, then you can do it yourself. They don't have to provide it. They are not going to market it. So as things stand today, if you want to invest in a direct plan, then simply go for a Nifty index fund and direct route. So any mutual fund houses, Nifty index fund, you can choose. And you are saying that ET Money and all are not providing. So they do have direct plans. So ET Money, Paytm Money, they have direct plans.
No, there. I'm aware of all of them. But what I'm saying is that if I say that this is for my kid, they would just back off.
Why? You have to tell them that it is for your kid.
What they say is that they do not have anything at the moment for kids, for minors, basically. That's what I meant. For minors, they're not enabling a direct plan for minors. So for adults, yes, it's always on.
You cannot invest in your kid's name. You can't do that. You have, because they don't have PAN number. minor cannot invest in stock market or in mutual funds. So
no. So I already
invest in your own name.
No. So I'm investing as a under guardian, you know, in the under guardian mode. So I only have a recourse to investing in the regular plans through an online mode, but not through a direct plan mode.
No, so if you sign up on GrowPath platform, if you sign up on Paytm Money, or if you sign up on ET Money, then they have direct plans.
Not in my name. I mean, I'm saying I want it in their name. So I have
that
right now.
Happen. That can't happen. You can't invest in your child's name. That you can't do.
Whilst I can invest online for a regular plan on an online platform, that is happening. So
no,
I have.
It is also not happening. No,
it is. I have for 3 years. I've been investing for my twins, so in a regular plan. But I can't move. I can't find a direct plan vendor who offers.
You're investing in a solution-oriented mutual fund.
Any mutual funds? Any like technology mutual funds? US mutual funds?
But you cannot invest in your son's or daughter's name. That is what I'm saying.
No, of course.
You have to have them as a minor.
Yeah, in the under guardian mode, there is a mode called as an under guardian mode. So they will not be able to sign. They will not be able to do anything. So I'm operating the account and they have a bank account in their name, which is in the under guardian mode. So basically, I have the rights to operate the account. So the bank, definitely. Yeah. So in that mode, I have regular plans. But my question and my query is about the absence of direct plans for kids, and I believe they are the real target segment. I mean, when we are talking about making sense of direct plans, we need to have an investment horizon of about 20 years to make sense out of that. Otherwise, it's just it doesn't make any sense.
See, direct plan meaning you are investing directly. So here, any kind of service from them is not possible, which is why this may not be happening, because if you are taking the regular route, then they will come back and say that, no, whatever query you may have, you can reach out to them and they will resolve it. But direct plan, again, it's you doing it yourself. So that is why they may not be taking it. But I would say that if you want to invest for your kid, then you can do that and taking direct route. I mean,
No.
As a system, Quera, having that option, then it will have to be regular, because of course they are providing a service and they will charge commission, then of course they will have regular.
No, so what I'm saying is that Quvera, Grow, ET Money, all of these direct platforms, Paytm, they're all direct platforms, right? They're not commission-based platforms. They're all selling, direct plans for adults. But when I say that, I want it for my kid, they would just back off. No, we are still in the, in the works. We are still trying to get things moving and blah, 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 and all of that. However, having said that, I am saying I am an investor since 3 years for my minor kids who are just 4 years old in regular plans. I hope I'm able to convey what I'm
Yeah, I understood. But yeah, this can only happen in regular. Why? Because then they will have to get actively involved in your investment if they are giving you something for your kids. And if that has to happen, then they have to have their own benefit, something they should also earn out of it. And it doesn't happen in direct plans. So maybe that is why they are not taking that route. Because if they are doing something, if they are for your kids, if an investment is happening, then they have to play a role there. Maybe that is why, and they don't have regular plans. They cannot charge you for it. Maybe that is why they are not taking that headache as of now. And going forward, it may happen. Because now if you see that a lot of new age AMCs are also coming. So Zerodha has got a license for mutual funds. And there are other such funds that even I think a lot of new players are coming in AMC business, and they are going to provide solution-based products. That if you want to invest for your child education, this is the mutual fund that you invest in. So such kind of targeted mutual funds are coming in. I have written a story about it in Fortune also. So going forward, it may happen. So such kind of products directly coming from mutual fund houses. So we are moving in that direction. But these firms, they cannot afford offering such things. They have direct.
That was a lot off track question. Prajita still elaborated it pretty well. I can see participants writing back to start the second part because many of them have their own commitments.
In private chat, I had shared my YouTube channel and contact. So I will just quickly type out my email ID and number and channel. So this is my YouTube. Again, it's direct, I think.
So guys, we will be now moving to the second part of the presentation where I talk to you, I explain you the entire CFP program framework. And those of you who have asked questions or who have raised hands, we haven't come to you till now. Don't worry, I'll come back to you at the end of the event because we have to kind of wrap it up because we have other commitments as well. So that's why I'm trying to be a little quick. So Aparajita has shared her contact details as well. Those of you who you want to reach Aparajita, you can take it from here. So perfect. So thank you so much, Aparajita, for being here. I know you have lot many other things to do. And today I literally kind of pulled you despite your other occupancies. So thank you so much for being here today with us. Have a great day.
I
look forward to seeing you again at ICFP.
Whenever you want, I can come back again. And I have shared my YouTube channel link also and contact and email ID or everyone. Feel free to reach out to me.
Yeah. And Aparajita, just one quick confirmation. So when my team sends the today's program communication to the participants, they will share your YouTube link.
Okay, sure.
Perfect. So once again, thank you so much, Aparajita, for being here with us today.
Thank you. All my pleasure. Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
So gentlemen, as I stated in the beginning that the conversation today is going to be in two parts. First, where Aparajita comes in and shares her industry experience, the expertise, whatever she has gathered over so many years. And the second part where I come in and I talk about world's topmost certification in personal finance, that's CFP, Certified Financial Planner. So those of you who joined late, I am Rajesh Kumar Singh, the Director and CEO for ICOFP, International College of Financial Planning. We are India's first and the largest CFP education provider. Rather, as a matter of fact, we brought the CFP education to India. So that way we carry absolute command and authority on the way program is structured, program is delivered, the curriculum, the content, the examination, everything. So that's a brief about us. Moving ahead. So at the outset, let me define the CFP program for you. Many of you would have heard about CFP, would have maybe probably even gone to FPSB website, would have read certain blogs, would have seen certain videos. So what is CFP? CFP, as I have already said twice, it is world's topmost certification in personal finance. It is recognized in 27 countries across the world. And when I say 27, it includes all the biggies like USA, UK, Canada, Australia, Singapore, all the biggies. It's a gold standard rated program, meaning to say it's a very highly standard, highly rated program. What makes the program all the more unique is that it is also world's only 4-in-1 certification program. When I say 4-in-1, I essentially mean that within one single program, you get 4 international certifications. So you study for one program, you in fact, the whole curriculum is linked in such a way that you study for one program, and you end up getting 4 international certifications. How that happens, I'll be explaining that to you as well. And because of this uniqueness of the curriculum and the way it is structured, the program is ideal for anybody and everybody, and literally anybody and everybody, right? From an undergrad who may be in the BBA first year or BSc first year or BCom first year, to the people who have even retired. So people who are 60, 65, I have a lot of students who come from army background, retired colonels, retired army officers coming and doing it. I have practicing surgeons coming and doing it. I have professionals, chartered accountants, the banking professionals, the BFSI domain experts, the vice presidents of banks, all these people coming and doing it. And yes, IFAs, the independent financial advisors, meaning to say the MFDs, the insurance advisors, the RIAs, people from all across these domains, who want to have financial advisory as their business coming and doing it. So for each of these segments, there are different reasons, different objectives that you want to drive from the program. But the end is the same. You aim to be a CFP, a Certified Financial Planner. So I'll talk about all of this today. What makes the program again a little more unique is the program is a highly focused program on personal finance and wealth management. So when I say highly focused, I essentially mean that, let me give you an analogy. You take out the curriculum of an MBA finance program. In an MBA finance program, typically there is not more than 40% of finance. All you end up studying is principles of management, economics, business law, corporate law, strategic management, organizational behavior, and all of that. Right. So, and even finance will have accounting, it will have financial accounting, it will have management accounting, it will have everything. Okay. Whereas the program that I am talking today to you, CFP, contains only and only about personal finance. So personal finance meaning to say finance which relates to a person, which relates to an individual, which can be my investments, my taxation, my goal setting, my financial planning, my retirement planning, everything. Yeah. So that way the content is very rich and it is tuned, it is customized as per the need of the industry, as per the demand of the industry. So that is one reason why the CFP professionals are highly demanded by the industry. Again, the program happens to be a short-term program. You can wrap it up. If you study pretty quickly, you can wrap it up even in 6 months time. But on an average, we have seen students completing it in 8 to 10 months time, 11 months time. So that's why I write it here as 8 to 10 months, but you can wrap it up early as well. And the entire examination, the entire program is online, meaning to say your enrollment to study to examination to certification, everything is online. So you can study wherever you are, whatever you are doing, without compromising on your work, without compromising on your studies. So that's the way the program is structured. Moving ahead. So what is the eligibility to do the program, to join the program? As I said, a lot of undergrads also join because undergrads have also started realizing that the typical BBA program or a BCom program doesn't carry that kind of significance in the industry today. So it's becoming more of a normal graduate program. So that's the reason why they want to support it with something which is a specialized, something which is a global certification. And that kind of multiplies their career growth or the job opportunities. So the minimum eligibility to do a CFP program, to enroll into a CFP program is 10 plus 2 and you have to be 18 years of age. There is no restriction on stream or percentages as such. Anybody and everybody can join the program. So that's about joining the program. But when you actually join the program and you complete the program, at the end of it, you get your charter, you get your membership. Right. So just like CA, CFP is also a membership based program. CA, CWA, CFA, all these are membership based program. Meaning to say you become a member of that institution after you pass the whole of the examination. So here as well, when you pass the exam, when you become a member, when you get your charter, the final certificate, by that time, you have to be a graduate, a minimum graduate. The question is, what if I am not a graduate? Then you will have to wait till the time your graduation results are done. Okay. And then you also need to have 3 years of experience in the BFSI domain. 3 years of experience in the BFSI domain, particularly. Again, the question is, what if I do not have 3 years of experience in the BFSI domain? Then you are supposed to be doing 1 year of supervised article set or training under a CFP. And this again can be done online. So 1 year of supervised article set, just like a CA article set, is what you're supposed to be doing under a CFP. So meaning to say, when you get your CFP certification, it is not only a symbol of you passing the exam, it is also a symbol of you carrying certain practical knowledge. That is the reason why either 3 years of experience or 1 year of articleship, that condition is inbuilt into the certification. So a little bit about the program structured, how the entire framework is made. So it's a multi-level program. So it's a program in four levels. Level 1, 2, 3, and CFP final. So that way the program is divided in four levels. And if you put together all these four levels, then you study 10 different subjects or 10 modules, so to say. So 10 modules you study in different levels. So level 1, you study 3 modules. Level 2, you study 2 modules. Level 3, you study 2 modules again. And then CFP final level, you study 3 modules, plus you do a project for a live, for a practical experience. So that makes it 10 modules for you in the whole program. And as I said, the final level includes projects and case studies. So the project is designed in such a way that whatever you have learned during those 10 modules earlier, that all kind of accumulates together in a very practical way. So you are given a live case of somebody, a person, his family and all, and you have to create a financial plan based on that case. So it's kind of execution of whatever you've learned in the practical sense. And the assessment during the program is that at the end of each of the levels, you have one exam happening. The exam is online. Exams happen once every month, generally in the third week of the month. So there is a prefix date, which is published two, three months in advance. You get that date, you can book your exam and you can take your exam from wherever you are. It's a very wonderful system of online examination, which is an online proctored exam. So when I say proctored exam, I essentially mean that somebody across the screen is sitting and watching you and you are appearing at your exam online. So it's a wonderful system. You can take the exam online. So talking more about program curriculum. So as I said, the program has got four levels. So level one is called investment specialist or investment planning specialist. It has three modules, I said earlier as well. The three modules are personal financial management, where you study more about the debit, credit, cash flows, assets, liabilities, the net worth, understanding of the personal finances of a person, the basics of personal finance concepts. And most importantly, we're going to study about time value of money, the future value of money, the present value of money, the loan amortization. So it has a bit of financial maths as well, pretty interesting financial maths, which you learn and then you kind of go on implementing when you advise your clients. The second module is investment planning and asset management. That, as the name suggests, here you study all about the investment products, the financial markets, the structure of financial markets, how to plan investments, and also has certain mathematical aspects related to your investments, like building up your portfolio, the risk. A risk measurement of your portfolio, the standard deviation of your portfolio, et cetera, et cetera. So that's in the investment planning and asset management. And the last one, regulatory environment and legal compliances, is about investment laws. So as a chartered accountant, when I was doing my CA, I studied about business law, I studied about company law, right? Now, similarly, as a CFP, when I do, I study investment laws because I am supposed to be an investment expert. How can there be an investment expert who doesn't know investment law, right? So the program teaches you investment laws as well. It's a theoretical subject, but then it will bring in all the SEBI acts, the RBI acts, the PFRD acts, the insurance, AMFI rules, regulations, everything put together in one module. And when you go through it, you understand the entire legal framework around the investments. So you complete level one, you take level one exam, and you are given a certification called Investment Planning Specialist from FPSB USA. So that's one international certification that you get. And then you quickly move on to level two. Level two, as I said, has got two modules. So retirement planning. Retirement planning is where you kind of start understanding the need of the financial planning. And because retirement is one of the most common things why you actually create a financial plan. Retirement is like seeing your future. How do you leave after 55 years, 60 years? When you are earning money, it's easy to leave. But what when you cease to earn money, how do you leave after that? So that's what you want to study in retirement planning, the entire computation, the plan making, how to draw safe for the retirement plan for your clients, etc. And then you have tax planning. Tax planning is again about the income tax planning for an individual. You will study about the taxation impacts, the various laws, everything related to Indian framework, but there would also be content on the global taxation system as well. So that makes the program far-reaching. Again, after that, you take level two exam, you pass level two exam, and you get this certification called Retirement and Tax Planning Specialist from FPSB USA. And then after that, you move to level three, which is Risk and Estate Planning Specialist. So here you have two modules. The first one is risk management and insurance, where you're going to study about how to assess the risk, what is risk, how to assess the risk, how to mitigate risk, what are the insurance products available, how do insurance products mitigate the risk, how to understand the right requirement of an insurance that a person needs. All those computations, all those mathematical elements are also built in the program. So it's a very comprehensive module around insurance that you study, and it covers all forms of insurance as well. And then you go on to study estate planning. So estate planning, not many people get confused with real estate. So hang on, it's not real estate. Estate planning is estate planning meaning I have my wealth. I have lived for, let's say, 35, 40 years or 50 years. I have created wealth for me. How do I pass on the wealth to the next generation? How do I pass on the wealth to the next generation? Meaning to say my wealth transfer. So my wealth transfer may involve a bit of litigation as well. I may have sons, daughters. I may wish to give something to somebody, and likewise. So all that is where what you study in the estate planning. So now if you look at the flow, the first module was about creating wealth. Second module was, now the wealth is created, so what to do next? So the second module was now planning for the future and saving taxes as well. So that is tax optimization and planning for the future. And third module, if you see, is mitigating risks of, on your investments, on your life as well. And then ready to pass on the wealth to the next generation. So in a way, you have studied the whole journey of wealth creation to the wealth transfer. That's what the program teaches you. And as I said, the last module is where whatever you have learned goes into finally getting translated in a very practical way. So what you have learned till now is making financial plan for a person. Now, imagine you are given a case that, okay, Rajesh Kumar Singh is a 41-year-old man. He lives in Delhi. His salary is this much. His wife is doing this. He has assets worth these crores, and he has a lifestyle like this. He travels twice for vacations. He does this, he does that. He has a 10-year-old daughter, and he wants his daughter to go to the US 10 years down the line. And likewise, if you see, so based on that case, then you will have to draw a financial plan for me, that what is Rajesh supposed to be doing? Whatever investment Rajesh is doing today, is that good enough to meet that plan? So that is what Aparajita was also talking today to you, goal-based financial planning. So in the last module, you kind of summarize all of that together, and you learn to make goal-based financial plans. But even before you make financial plans, you study three more modules, which are to prepare you for that practical area, practical aspect. The first module that you study is financial planning process and skills, where you learn how to make a financial plan, the process of making a financial plan, the formats, the litigation involved, the framework, what to disclose, what not to disclose, how to disclose, everything goes into that. Then the second is engaging clients in the financial plan making process. So let's say you are my financial planner. You have made probably the world's best financial plan for me. But as a client, if I'm not convinced with your plan, it won't work. So that also you study, that how to engage your clients in the financial plan making process so that you buy his conviction. So that all gets covered. And then the last one is developing effective financial plans, is how to design the plan now. Okay, how to design, what elements will come in, how do you structure it, how to summarize, how to present the recommendations, how to present the review thing. So all that gets covered. When everything is done, then you get a capstone project. So capstone project is a project which is assigned by FPSB USA directly to you. It doesn't come through us. It comes to you directly by FPSB USA. You prepare your financial plan based on that case, submit to FPSB USA, and then they approve your project. And then you move on to take your CFP final exam. So that's about the program structure. So it's a very comprehensive program where you have theory, you have numericals, you have maths, you have laws, you have interesting subjects, and you have kind of very practical learning, implementing and executing, everything happening in one program itself. Okay, so moving ahead. So what is the learning outcome? What happens when you actually do CFP program? So the learning outcome is one in terms of knowledge and skills, if I have to talk about. So what knowledge and skills you build? You have seen the content. I have explained you the content, what is going to be there in the program. Okay, so basis that content, if you just summarize this, you will be able to relate to every single word that I'm gonna speak to you. So what knowledge and skills you build is you become an expert into personal finance, you become an expert into wealth management, managing portfolios, doing financial advisory. You know how to plan investments, you know how to plan taxes. So meaning to say your person, your client need not depend on a chartered accountant anymore. See, your client going to a CA for tax advice today is actually is going to a CA and in making investment through you. Why? Because you are not able to do the tax planning for him. The day you do that service to him, probably he'll stick to you because nobody knows his investment better than you. So you will be able to do that. Then estate planning. So people prepare wills, people make trust to pass on the will to the next generation. And your client, for all these reasons, all these things today, goes to a lawyer today. Not to he doesn't talk to you because you do not know what is estate planning. So the idea is that you become an expert on all these areas which a person needs and you are able to cater to all of that. Now, interestingly, investment laws is one area which neither the lawyers are able to cater nor the chartered accountants. Because chartered accountants, we study more of business law and company law. We don't study more about investment laws. And the financial advisors per se do not have any specialized study of investment laws. Whatever they study is only in the open world. So that's the reason why investment law is something which becomes a Google subject. So if your client asks you, you probably go Google and ask him and answer him. That doesn't help. So you knowing investment laws is very important. That's what the program does. It teaches you income tax laws, succession laws, everything. Okay. Another interesting thing about the program is it teaches you how to use financial calculators, MS Excel, doing financial maths on the Excel, understanding the uses of time value of money. All that is very important. So today when you say your client that, look, if you deposit this 10,000 rupees in this SIP for 30 odd years at the with the assumption of 6% inflation and 10% of growth, what is your money going to be? If he asks you that, not that you should be looking at the mutual fund came as a sample or anywhere else and answering him. You should be able to explain that to him with a simple formula in Excel or a simple two-key stroke on your financial calculator, and you should be able to tell it to him. So you become very skilled in all these areas with this program, right? You become an expert wealth manager, a portfolio analyst. So that's about the knowledge and skills. And in terms of the career, what all career options are open for you is you can get into the banking and financial services, wealth management, the stockbroking companies, the financial planning firms, the tax advisory companies. You can set up your own financial advisory firm. You can become an IFA. You can get into fintech startups. So I don't know, some of you were asking that, are there fintech startups on financial planning? One promising fintech startup on financial planning is Fintu. So you can go and Google. They have a beautiful system of financial planning, absolutely financial planning, not just selling you mutual funds or not just selling. Kubera and all may be tempted towards, they are inclined towards pushing you to mutual funds. Fintu is not that. Fintu allows you to create your financial plan the way a man does. Though, of course, it cannot be as comprehensive as a human advisor does, but they have tried making it that way. Okay, so that's about it. You can get into portfolio management companies, the asset management companies, mutual fund, insurance. You can also become a financial coach. You can be a teacher, you can be a trainer, you can be a faculty. And then, of course, the unconventional innovative careers like financial journalism, blogging, and all is open. By the way, Aparajita today, as I said, she happens to be our alumnus. So not only Aparajita, you go and Google Monica Hallan. Monica Hallan also happens to be our alumni. She is, again, a well-known financial journalist, a writer as well. Her book, Let's Talk Money, is the talk of the town today. So she happens to be our alumnus as well, and we'll try to bring her someday to you. Okay, so moving ahead, who are we? And so ICOP, I said in the beginning while I was introducing myself, so we are a part of the Bajaj Capital Group. We have been in the industry since 2002. And as a matter of fact, this program CFP was brought to India by us. So we are an institution where right from the leadership to the people who teach you, every single person is a CFP, is a certified financial planner. And the most experienced and qualified CFP faculty. So all my faculties, when I say all, I essentially mean all 100%, not even 99.99. all my faculties come from CAP, CFA, CA, and PhD, all that background. So you will have the program director, Madhu Sinha. The program director for CAP at ICAP is Ms. Madhu Sinha. Madhu Sinha herself happens to be the former director of FPSB India board. Now imagine the former director of FPSB India board herself coming and teaching you. Okay, so that's the kind of stellar faculties that we have. You have faculties who are chartered accountants, who have worked with companies like Goldman Sachs, KPMG for 10 years or 15 years, and they come and teach you. You have faculties who have studied with institutions like IIM Bangalore, and they are CFPs and they are coming and teaching you. You have faculties who, the people who come and teach you investment planning, investment laws, or maybe succession laws or retirement things. You will have some faculties who are CFPs, who are advocates as well, right? And they are practicing advocates with the Delhi High Court, Supreme Court that way, right? So stellar faculty members with very rich experience in the corporate world, in the academic world. So we have tried to bring the best of the CFP faculties. And I'm extremely proud to say that when it comes to CFP passing percentage, we are far ahead of the industry average. The industry keeps doing somewhere around 52-53% average. We have been clocking more than 80%, 82-83% average consistently over the last 19 years. And we have also have had a 100% passing percentage, 100% we have also touched. Okay, and this is not that I'm saying here for the sake of it. You can go and check my LinkedIn page, Rajesh Kumar Singh, ICFP. Check my page on LinkedIn, and you will see FPSB India CEO coming and congratulating me on my team achieving this stellar achievement, doing this stellar achievement. So we have done it consistently over the last 19 years. We have ensured that we have the highest passing percentage. And that happens because we have a very comprehensive, well-structured study material available for you. And what are the study options? How do you study for CFP program with us? So one is the classroom, meaning to say you come to our classes, our campuses at Delhi and Mumbai, and we teach you live there. But this is suspended since COVID. We do not intend to go back to classroom at least for next 3-4 months. We are happy doing it online because with online, we are able to teach students across India. We have students from Middle East. We have students from Canada. We have students from Australia. So we are happy teaching online. And that's why this classroom thing is suspended for the time being. The most successful and most opted for study option is a virtual live class, which is an instructor-led live class where we teach you on Zoom like this. The only difference is because this is a webinar, so we have kept all of you on mute. That is a virtual class, so you are allowed to speak. It's a two-way class that happens. The faculty teaches you live. And then you have options for both weekdays or weekends. So if you go for weekdays, we will teach you Monday to Friday, 7:30 to 9:30. Okay, Monday to Friday, 7:30 to 9:30 every day. That's weekdays. If you opt for weekends, it's Saturday, Sunday only. Saturday late evening, Sunday first half. Now, not many of you ask which one is better, okay? See, the same faculty, the same content, exactly same. There is not even an iota of difference that we keep in weekdays and weekends. The same faculty, the same content, the same way, the same style is done. The only thing is, weekdays is where we teach you 5 days. So meaning to say, in a week, I'll be teaching you 10 hours. And in a month, we will be teaching you 40 hours. In the weekdays, we teach you 2 hours a day. So 4 hours a week. So in a month, 16 hours. So if you go for weekdays, your speed, your pace for the study is faster. If you go for weekends, your pace or your study pattern is a little slower. But having said that, I would again say to the main point is it all depends on you how much time you can take out. If you think you can take out time to study every day in the evening, 7:30 to 9:30, fair enough, join us for weekdays. If you think, no, I am preoccupied with the weekdays, I would be happy taking out time on weekends, join us on weekends. So you have both the options available. And if at all you miss any single class, any class, or even if you do not miss the class, all the classes are recorded and the recordings are shared with you so that you can rewind, review the video as many times as you wish, and you can kind of revise the concepts. And then the last one is e-learning sessions. E-learnings are pre-recorded sessions wherein the same experts who teach you in the virtual live class, but this is not live. The experts have sat on a screen and have recorded their lessons on a video earlier, and those videos are shared with you. It's more of a DIY kind of do it yourself kind of a thing. So we give it the content, you study at your own pace. And it is ideal for, it is recommended for people having existing relevant background. So somebody who is a chartered accountant, if he wishes to do, I would say e-learning may be good enough for him to do. But if somebody who is an IFA, somebody who wants a very practical thing, who wants an interactive class, go for virtual. Yeah, so you have all the options open, depends on you what you would like to do. As I was talking about study materials that we offer, so we give you printed books, concept books. So you get 10 books, printed books from ICFP. We give you books, we give you workbooks so that you can practice questions. Now imagine all these study materials that we offer you sits on the top of the study material which FPSB gives you. So when you enroll in the CFP program, FPSB has made it mandatory that you have to subscribe to their learning content. It is mandatory. Nobody can escape that. So you have to subscribe to their learning content. So they will also give you some content, but that will be online. You can't save it. You can't download it. You can't print it. So you have to study it online. And the number of questions that they give you in practice is around 40, 50, 60 questions in one module. Whereas the number of questions that we give you in the workbook for you to practice is around 600 to 1000 questions in each module. So imagine the kind of quantum of practice that we bring to you. That's the reason why I call that we offer you India's most comprehensive study material. So you get books, you get workbooks, you do projects. As I said, all the classes are recorded, the videos are shared with you. You can review the video as many times as you wish. You have mock tests made into ICFP learning management system. So the way you take exam at FPSP in the similar environment, in the simulated environment, you take an online exam with us before you take the final exam so that you are a little better prepared as compared to others. You do assignments during the classes, you have case studies, you have guest lectures, and above all of this, before every exam, we do an exclusive doubt clearing session with you as well, where our experts, our faculties come and they give you a last minute brush up to you, to your preparation, so that you are far more prepared to take the exam. So that's our delivery model. That's our study materials. Now coming to the fees. So primarily the fees are in two parts. One, the fee that you pay to the certifying authority, which is FPSB USA board. So because it is an USA board, so the money that you pay to them goes in dollars. And then you pay the fees to ICFP, to me, for teaching you the CFP program. So CFP studies fees comes to me in Indian rupees, and CFP program fee goes to FPSB USA, that goes in Indian, in US dollars. So the structure is like this. Now, once you join the program, the first thing that you do is you study with us. You do not join FPSB. You do not register FPSB directly. Why? Because your FPSB registration is valid only for a year. So if you join them today and you, let's say, invest first 3 months in studying for the program, then your validity is actually left with 9 months only, not 12 months. So why to do that? So what we recommend is you study with us. When you are halfway through the program, then only you go and register with FPSB. So that way you end up saving your 1.5-2 months time as well. So you start studying, then it comes, you register with FPSB. The registration amount is $165. After that you also pay the content fee. As I was saying, FPSB has made it mandatory for you to pay the content fees up to buy their content, their learning content. That is mandatory, you have to pay. It is $60 for each of the levels, 1, 2, 3, and $120 for the final level. If you sum all of this together, it is $300, but this is not paid in one go. This is pay at an approximate gap of 1 to 2 months or 2 to 3 months, depending on how fast you move up the ladder. Okay. So it goes one by one, level by level. It is not paid in one go. So the whole program, the fee is paid in that way, in the kind of staggered manner. It's not one-time payment. Then comes examination. When you are ready for the examination, you go and book your exam. For the examination, you pay $61 for 1, 2, 3, and $122 for the last one, the CFP final. Again, if you sum all of this, it comes to 305. Similar pattern, similar way, this is paid in a staggered manner, level-wise, not in one go. When you complete your specialist certification, level 1, 2, 3, when you complete, you get specialist certification for each of these levels. When you complete your specialist certification, your specialist exams, you get a specialist certification from FPS BSA. Now, for that, you pay $100 as your certification fee. Now, $100 is again common for all three. It's not $100 each, it's $100 for all three. And when you complete your CFP final exam, you get your charter, your membership. For that, again, you pay a one-time fee at the end. That's $120, and you get your final CFP certification. So that's about the fee that you pay to FPS BUSA. Now, coming to CFP study fees that you pay to us. So you have both the options. You can join us level-wise level. If you say, no, I will join for level one, then I'll move to level two, then I'll move to level three. We are happy to do that. You can join us level-wise, or you can join us for the four-in-one thing together, four-in-one study mode together. The advantage for you is when you join for four-in-one study programs, because it's bundled, so you end up saving close to 45% of the fee, of the study fee. So if you see here, if you go level by level, level for level one, you pay 15,000 in virtual, 12,500 for level two in virtual, and 12,500 for level three in virtual, and 15 again for the final level in virtual. If you sum all of this together, you end up paying 55,000. But if you join for 4-in-1, you pay just 37,500, meaning to say you get close to 47% saving on your fees, study fees. So that's the advantage of joining the 4-in-1 program together. So 37,500 for virtual, 27,500 for e-learning. That's the fee, your study fee at ICFP that you pay to us and you join the program. Okay, I truly appreciate, gentlemen. This is like an early evening. You came out today. You are definitely interested in knowing about CFP. And Aparajita had a wonderful talk. She told you about her reasons to do CFP, how she came from an arts background, and she explored her career here, and what she is doing today. And she talked about unconventional careers and lot many other stuff. And I explained you various reasons, knowledge, skills that CFP program does for you. So that essentially means that you are somewhere down the line exploring your interest in this domain, in the financial planning domain, in the industry. So gentlemen, for you, there is an offer today. The offer is a very special one, a very special offer today. If you join us today, the price, you will get a discount price, another 5,000 rupees discount on the fee. So virtual, which was 37,500, becomes 32,500 only, and e-learning, which was 27,500, becomes 22,500 only, right? So that's the discounted fee for today. And then there is a discount on 50% discount on FPSB content fee. If you remember, I was saying that FPSB has made it mandatory that you have to subscribe to their learning content, and that fee is $60 each for 1, 2, 3, and $120 for the end one. So it totals out to $300. So when you join us today, we give you discount coupons when you subscribe to those content. And at that time, when you apply the coupons that I give you, you will end up saving 50%. So that means instead of $300, you will pay them only $150. So that saves you another 12,000 rupees, close to 12,000 rupees in terms of INR. So that's another benefit of joining today. 5,000 rupees you save on the program fee, and then 12,000 rupees you get saved in terms of FPSB fees as well. And another reason for you to join today is we offer you interest-free student loan, 0%, absolutely 0%. The NBFC would charge you certain processing fees, some 900 rupees or whatever, but the student loan will not have any interest at all. So you can join us today. All you need to do is pay the 10% of the amount, block your seat, the remaining can be paid into EMIs through the NBFC arrangement. So that's there, 6 easy EMIs. The paperwork, documentation, everything happens online. So there is no challenge as such, and it's pretty simple to join. So excited about joining. And okay, so knowing that I had a special request today from some of the participants. I have seen here in chats, as well. So knowing that tomorrow there is a festival, Karwa Chauth, and some women participants here are saying they would be busy today, they can't enroll. So, and this is something that my team was also talking to me today. So this offer would be will be valid till Monday only, knowing that we have a festival tomorrow. So this offer will be valid till Monday only. Don't come back to us requesting for this offer on Tuesday. Till Monday, you can enroll with us and take advantage of this offer. You can avail this offer. How to do is, how to go about is, call us on this number or visit us on the website. We have a chat button, or you can call us on this number, 9711-43779. My team would be happy to connect you. My team would be happy to help you. If any one of you want to speak to me personally, you can call on this number and just tell my team that you want to speak to me personally, and they would bridge your call to me. They would give you my number, and we can speak on one-on-one basis.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, sir, but we have to wind up within 2 to 3 minutes because we have another webinar schedule on the same panel.
Yeah. Okay. So I think I've answered most of the questions. It says total course, entire fees. I have explained already the fees, the payment plan, everything. Repeat all the charges again. Fees, I mean to say. So fees is here. So this is the fee that you pay for study. And this is the fee that you pay to the USA board. So that all is done. So I told you the minimum qualification you were asked to do is 10+2, and you are a mechanical engineer, a diploma in mechanical engineering. So your diploma is 3 years diploma. So that would be valid for this program. What is course duration? Course duration, I've explained, this is about typically around 8 to 10 months, but you can wrap it up as early as possible. Rajesh Misra is asking a question, what is CFP-CM? So CFP is Certified Financial Planner. The word CM that you write as a super strike there is, CM is collective mark. So as a CA, I get a collective mark. I can write CA before my name. I can write CA Rajesh Kumar Singh. Similarly, CFP is also a collective mark. I can write after my name, Rajesh Kumar Singh CFP. So that's a distinction. That's an honor that you have to use that CFP tag, CFP-CM. A collective mark in your name, with your name. So that's a distinction for this course as well. What about fees paid towards renew CFPs? So renewal happens after the year, Mr. K.S. Rajput. I'm not confusing that here. Why? Because the participants may not even be talking about renewal. Renewal has a different process. You earn some CPD points and then you pay the renewal fees. That happens with any of the membership-based program. That is why I was talking about membership-based program. As a CA as well, I have to renew my license every year. As a CFA as well, a person has to renew licenses every year. You need to pay CFA membership fee. Similarly, you pay their membership fee here as well. Is it necessary to join a study group for the CFP exam, Sanjay Pradhan? No, it is not mandatory at all. You can take a hit at yourself. You can go and study online with whatever content FPSB gives you. But imagine FPSB gives you online content, no books to study, everything is online, you can't even save, you can't even print. If you are happy studying it, fair enough. No videos. If you are happy studying without videos, fair enough. Each workbook will have a question of around 40-50 practice questions. And if you are happy, 40-50 questions, if you think you can, based on 40-50 questions, you are ready to take the exam, fair enough. So that depends on you. I am somebody who has been teaching for the last 19 years. I know what to teach, how to teach. So that's my expertise. Okay, so I think I've answered most of the questions. Still, if there are anything, there are questions which are left. I am extremely sorry because we have, as my team also shared, we have another event lined up. And unfortunately, I'm the speaker there as well. So I'll have to quickly move on to that event. But still, if you have queries, I would love to answer that. You can call us on this number. My team is there to help you. Or if you want to speak to me, just tell them that you want to speak to me and they will give you my number. We can talk on one-on-one and I'll be more than happy to help all of you. So with that, thank you so much for joining us today. Kanaya, can we sign off?
Yes, sir, we can.
Perfect. So bye-bye, gentlemen, and I look forward to seeing you again soon.
Thank you.